We cancel every assignment of hell over the schools in Joss, in Jesus' name. We apply the blood of Jesus over them. Korabasaya. Leko koko shete malaba. Robo koto yegede. Reko konomo sente yarababa. In Jesus' name we have prayed.
Amen.
Amen and amen. The Lord will continue to protect us, protect our cities, our nations, our families in the name of Amen. Jesus. These are very dangerous and perilous times, but we thank God that we are in Christ and we are hidden in Him. Praise God. I'm going to just bring a word, a message to us tonight. Usually when we bring a message like that, it's something that we sense that the Lord is saying to the body of Christ, to the church. It's not just the church in the UK, but even the church all over the world. Hallelujah. Amen. So we are going to be declaring the word of God. I want us to turn our Bibles quickly to the book of Hosea. Hosea chapter 7, verse 8 to 9. Hosea chapter 7, verse 8 to 9. Father, we pray, cause our ears to open. Speak to us in a deep way, in a clear way. Let us hear your voice in the voice of the person speaking. Speak to us, oh God, and Lord, touch a chord within us in the name of Jesus. Transform our lives, change us, and draw us closer to yourself in the name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said, Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hosea 7, 8 to 9. It says, Ephraim has mixed himself among the peoples. Ephraim is a cake unturned. Aliens have devoured his strength, but he does not know it. Yes, gray hairs are here and there on him. Yet, he does not know it. Now, when we look at who Ephraim is, Ephraim was one of the two sons of Joseph. One was Manasseh and the other one was Ephraim. And when it was time for Jacob to die, he decided to lay his hands on Ephraim instead of Manasseh, who was the firstborn. Hallelujah. So while Joseph was in Egypt, he had his children. Ephraim was the younger son, but was later adopted by Jacob as his firstborn over Manasseh after rejecting Reuben. Reuben was his firstborn. He rejected Reuben because we all know what Reuben did by going into his father's concubine. But after that, he now decided to adopt Ephraim as his firstborn. And we find that, you know, I'm not going to read that because it's in Genesis 48, 17 to 19, but because of time, I'm not going to read it. But when Joseph brought his two children to his father to bless them, after the manner of the elders, of the fathers, before they go the way of the world, you know, he will lay their hands on them and release a generational blessing over them. But then, you know, Joseph put Manasseh on the front, on the right side, the right hand of Jacob. But then Jacob just turned his hand and crossed his hand and put his right hand over Ephraim and put his left hand over Manasseh, choosing Ephraim over Manasseh. And that's why we don't hear about the tribe of Joseph. We hear about Ephraim. So Ephraim was adopted and grafted in as one of the 12 tribes of Israel. And sometimes the whole of Israel and the northern kingdom will be referred to as Ephraim. So in this passage that is referring to Ephraim as a cake unturned, he was speaking about the whole nation of Israel. Hallelujah. And when I checked the name of Ephraim, it means fruitful. Ephraim means fruitful. He was favored. He was chosen. He was blessed. He was great. He's full of all good things of heaven and earth. He was prominent. He was strengthened by God. He was helped by God. Can you imagine you being the younger? In fact, we see this a lot in scripture, and I'm still trying to understand why sometimes God will choose the younger over the older one. And that is because of election, because of God's purpose, because of destiny, because God predestines people. He knows them before they were born, while they were yet in their mother's womb. He knew what they were going to be. He knew what they were going to accomplish. And so we find that, you know, Ephraim, being fruitful, was a favored person. And just like Ephraim or Israel, we believers in Christ, the church of Jesus, we have been chosen by God. We have been adopted into his family, elected to be his ambassadors, blessed with all spiritual blessings. He has given us authority, dominion, and power. The Bible tells us in Romans 8:15, it says, for you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. 1 Peter 2:9 says, we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that we may proclaim the praises of him who has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Hallelujah. What an honor that the Lord has given to us. Sometimes we don't realize all that accrues to us in Christ Jesus as children of God. We should be living on earth here with our head high, because we are not even from this world. We are from another kingdom. And in that kingdom, the power of God rules. Amen. And we carry that power because we carry God on the inside of us. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But what was heaven's lamentation over Ephraim? Hosea 7, 8-9, he said, Ephraim has mixed himself among the people. This is a nation, a people chosen by God to be over all the nations, to teach other nations how to worship God, to teach other nations to fear God. This is a nation that when they appear, all the other nations are afraid of them because they know God was with them. They heard of all the mighty miracles God did on their behalf, that God defended them. The Bible says that they went from nation to nation. He said they suffered no man to do them wrong. He reproved kings for their sake, saying, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. God protected them. God guarded them. He said even in the afflictions, he was afflicted. He said he lifted them up. Hallelujah. So we must understand that God had endowed Israel. He had endowed Ephraim with so much power, with so much dominion and authority to be his representative on the earth, so that when they speak, it's as if God was speaking. Hallelujah. But what happened? Something happened. You know, beloved, I want to say to us that the enemy does not have a right into our lives except what we give him. Except we open the door. He doesn't have the right to just barge into your life. If you don't open the door, he doesn't come in. Whenever you open the door for the enemy, if you open the door and give him an inch, he will take a mile. And that is the principle. That is the principle. Anytime you open the door, the enemy comes in. And that is what happened. Remember the story of Balak and Balaam. You know, Balak hired Balaam to go and curse the children of Israel. But he could not curse them because they were blessed by God. They were the apple of his eyes. They were the chosen. Israel, my glory. God covered them with his wings, with his feathers. He watched over them with his eyes. Everywhere they went, God was with them. And because God has invoked upon them a blessing, they could not be cursed. So he tried, he could not curse them. And eventually, when we read other parts of the Bible, we find that Balaam, he counseled Balak on what to do. He said they should just expose them to the daughters of Moab so that they can commit fornication with the daughters of Moab. And immediately they do that, the hedge is broken. Once the hedge is broken, a serpent will bite. And that is the only thing that causes Israel to become a slave instead of a prince and a king. The Bible tells us, I have seen an error under the sun. The slaves are riding on horses and the kings are walking barefoot. And the only reason that that happens is because of the iniquity, the sin. Open the door to the enemy, dining with the enemy, dancing with the enemy, eating with the enemy, and the enemy comes in. And because of that, they lose their strength. They become weak. The same nation that people are afraid of are now becoming slaves. That will not be our portion. Amen. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So he said, Ephraim has mixed himself among the people. Ephraim, the people of God, they have mixed up, mixed multitude. They've mixed up with the world. They've mixed up with the heathen. They've imbibed and adopted the culture of the hidden world, their idolatry. They began to, you know, envy them. They wanted to do what they were doing, you know, but they've forgotten who they were, that they are not of them. And this is speaking to us as people of God. Don't let us get entangled. Don't let us be of the world. We don't want to lose our strength. Don't let us entangle ourselves with their fears of this world, with their ungodly ways, ungodly systems, the way they do their things. You know, in our time now, sometimes it's very difficult to know who a child of God is and who is a child of the devil, because there's a mixture. People are entangled with stuff that they shouldn't get involved in. May God deliver us and help us to be separate, you know, to distinguish ourselves. because we are the excellence of God. Amen. He has chosen us and he has laid his hands upon us. We are different from the world. Jesus said, even though we are in this world, we are not of it. We don't belong to it. We should separate ourselves. He says, come out from among them and be separate. When we entangle ourselves with the things of the world, we lose our edge, we lose our power, we lose our authority, we lose our influence. The Bible says, you know, an unrighteous man, is it a wicked man runs when no man pursues? Because he's wicked, he's always afraid. He can't be bold anymore. You lose your boldness. You lose your authority. When the enemy comes, instead of confronting him boldly, you are saying, in Jesus' name, I'm warning you. I'm warning you. Hey, hey, hey. You are praying panic, fearful prayer because you don't even know who you are anymore. And you are afraid because you know what you have done. That will not be our testimony. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. When we are entangled, just like Ephraim, we get distracted and are not able to focus on the important things of the kingdom of God. You know, let us not touch the unclean. Let us keep ourselves pure and holy. We are in the end times, as we can see. And God is calling us as the church to be the church, to be the glorified church, the purified church, the church without wrinkle, without blemish that Jesus Christ is coming for. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. The Bible tells us, he said, Ephraim is a cake, not turned. A cake, not turned. That means he's cooked on one side. He's half-baked. You know, when you are frying something, maybe you're frying egg and you fry one side or whatever you are frying, that you fry one side and you need to turn it, but it's not turned, and you turn off the cooker and you think it's done, but you know it's not done inside. You can see it's not done, but outside the other side is cooked. That is what he was saying. He says, Ephraim, that is a metaphor. It's a metaphor describing their condition, their state as a people, as a nation. He says, you know, when you hear of half-baked Christians, what do you think? Christians that are one leg in, one leg out. Those who don't have depth. They don't have depth in the word. I want to tell us that, you know, in these few months that we have gone through this shaking all over the world, I believe we were all being tested. Our faith is being tested. This thing shook everybody. Because even those who did not catch it, there's a tiny fear of, I don't know. I don't know. It's shaking everybody's faith. Some people, their jobs are on the line. So many things are happening. It's a test for every one of us to see the stuff we are made of. What is inside of us? When God tests us, when he tries us, he wants to see what we are made of. Is their faith still there or not? Hallelujah. So he says, it's a cake unturned, half baked. Those who don't have depth in the word, this is the time we need to put the word in our spirit. No prayer life. Insensitivity to the things of the spirit. Too busy for God. Too busy to spend time in the presence. You know, if we don't do these things, there are some things that are just natural for us as believers. If we don't do them, we are going to become weak believers. And weak believers cannot do much in the end time schemes of God. Amen. You know, a cake that is not turned means they are too hasty for the process of God. Mm-hmm. You know, you are not cooked. We're not cooked. No, I want to run out there and do certain things. But you have not tarried. You have not waited. You have not allowed God to breathe on you. Jesus said to his disciples, tarry in Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high. But some of us want to run out without having the right ammunition. Without having what we, all the instruments that we need to confront all the Jezebels out there. God wants us to tarry in his presence. He says, Ephraim is a cake unturned. It's half-baked. It's not cooked. God wants us to be sons and daughters who are solid in him. So we need to cooperate with the process of God. Sometimes God is fashioning some of us. He's polishing us. He's preparing us. He wants to get us ready for the things that he wants to do in our lives. But we are too hasty. He puts us on the altar. We say, oh, Lord, I'm on the altar. Lord, altar of sacrifice. Do something in me. Prune me. Oh, purge me, Lord. Prune me, God. Oh, then after a while, so I'm getting tired of this altar. Oh, this place, I want to jump down. Then you jump down from the altar of sacrifice and say, hey, God is too slow. You know, let me just go and do things by myself. You know, Ephraim is a cake unturned. It's not cooked. It's not strong. It is weak. Hallelujah. The Bible wants us to be rooted in Christ. Colossians 2:6-7. You can read it later. Let us use this time, this lockdown time, to build ourselves up in the Lord. Amen. To be rooted, to be grounded, to be established. You know, when the wind blows, the wind of adversity blows, the wind of problem blows, the wind of trouble blows, and then the wind blows you like paper. And then you are like featherweight. But if you are solid and you are rooted and established, no matter the wind that blows, it will not blow you away. Hallelujah. It's like those who hear the words of Jesus and they do it. They shall be like those who are built on the rock, on solid rock, so that when the storm comes, remember in that parable, he didn't say the storm did not come to the one whose house was built on the rock. The storm came to both of them, both the foolish and the wise. And so when we, in fact, I believe that in these end times, we need to begin to focus on training the people of God to be strengthened, to equip the church, to bring edification in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. God wants us to raise strong Christians, especially in the times that we live in. In the times that we live in. Hallelujah. Amen. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He says, Ephraim, strangers, aliens have sapped his strength. Aliens have devoured his strength, and he did not even know it. God forbid that we lose something. Something dissipates from our life. We are not aware. We didn't even know when it left. Like some people say, most times we know when the Spirit of God comes upon us, the anointing comes. But when the anointing leaves, many people don't even know, quietly, because they don't know. Just like Samson, that Samson lost his power. He lost his strength because he lost his what? Consecration. He lost his consecration. He lost that, you know, fellowship with God. He lost the power. So he lost his strength. And when they caught him and got that his eye, he was going to, you know, do as he used to do before. Rise up and just tear everybody into pieces. But it didn't work. The power had gone. The strength had left. Hallelujah. That will not be our portion. It says, Ephraim, strangers have sapped his strength. And he didn't know it. Firstly, what is the strength? You know, the dictionary definition of strength is the capacity of an object or substance to withstand great force or pressure. The capacity of an object or a person or substance to withstand pressure or great force. When the enemy throws things at us, are we able to stand? What is our capacity in the spirit? God wants our capacity to be large, so that we can accommodate whatever is coming. Beloved, weight has glory. I mean, glory has weight. So there's a weight of glory that is coming. But if your capacity is small, how can you contain it? Hallelujah. When the enemy throws things at us, can we stand? The Bible says we should be strong in the Lord. Strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Amen. Not in our own strength, in the Lord. If God is telling us to be strong in the Lord, there's a reason we need to be strong. We cannot be weak in these end times, because the enemy of our soul is lurking. He wants to take us out. The Bible says he's roaring everywhere. He wants to devour. In these end times, he wants to take people out of their faith. He doesn't want them to even have a faith. He wants to shake them. But you know, beloved, we have a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Hallelujah. And we need to stand firm in that. We need to stand firm in that. Praise God. The Hebrew word for strength is hayil, and it means a military fortification. It means your ammunition, army, forces, your armor, power, ability, valiance, virtue, substance, and wealth. This speaks of the ammunition and privileges we have in Christ that gives us advantage over the world and the enemy. But primarily, this word strength, hayil, speaks of military armory, military fortification, fortified. Hallelujah. So what are the armory? Well, it's telling us here that, you know, strangers came in, foreigners. They came in unawares, and they began to sap the spiritual fortification, all the armory, all the ammunitions, all the instruments of defense of Ephraim. And he didn't even know it until they took everything. It doesn't start at once. They don't do it at once. It's gradually. Hallelujah. You know, he wants to take away your shield of faith, your faith, so that when things are happening, instead of having faith, you are afraid. You are not using your shield of faith. The Bible says when Jesus comes, will he find faith on the earth? Faith is a weapon. Amen. We fight with it. We also defend ourselves with it. So it comes in to take it away. You don't have any more strength even to fight, even to stand in faith. It takes away the word from your mouth. You don't have any word inside your belly so that you can use it as a sword against the enemy. Amen. And you know, we know that the Holy Spirit uses the word of God that is inside us as a sword. He wants to take all that. He wants to take our prayer. Prayer is a weapon. Prayer is a weapon. He wants to make people become prayerless. Sap, coming unawares and sap all their prayer life. Sap all their prayer energy. So they don't feel like praying. Even when they kneel down to pray, within 5 minutes, they're falling asleep. And exactly that's where the devil wants you. Because when he's able to shut your mouth in the place of prayer, then he will come in to wreak havoc and attack. That will not be our portion. God will strengthen us and pour a fresh grace of prayer and anointing upon our lives in the name of Jesus. The strangers wants to sap people's prayer life, taking all their weapons away. These strangers, how did they even come in? To devour the strength, and he did not know. How can he not know? Strangers are hidden things that gradually and cunningly take what is yours. Without your agenda, without your knowing, without your knowledge, because the strangers first become your friend. Let me tell you, because there are strategies and schemes of the devil. The stranger will become familiar with you first. Hallelujah. Because if you know that he had an agenda, you won't open your door. But you don't know, except by you being able to discern, child of God. That's why we need to be discerning in the spirit. Honestly, our Christian walk is a spiritual walk. It's a spiritual battle. You cannot be on this world, in this earth, and not be spiritually aware. And not be spiritually aware. A lot of battles are raging all around us. The enemy is trying to take us out. He wants us to deny our faith. We must stand. Hallelujah. So he first of all becomes your friend. I'm going to rush and hurry so that we can, you know, pray and go into communion. But with a hidden agenda. They don't take things from you at once. Like I said, they come gradually. They first of all make you one with them, become their friend, become familiar with you, and you take it in. Like the TV. It doesn't matter. Let me just watch some soap opera. From one soap opera to another one, to another one, to another one. And then all the things that you felt before that you used to count as important, now they don't matter. You know, it's okay. It's okay. And they become your friend, and you give excuses for them. You know what? I'll pray later. Oh, it's your prayer time. The alarm has just gone off. Let me finish watching this. I will pray later. I'll pray later. At the end of the day, you don't pray. You don't pray. Gradually, the things, you know, that you are now allowing, they are dulling you in the spirit. You become dulled. Spiritual strength is going. Your fire is dying out. The things that you used to overcome now overcome you. And you are now in bondage to those things. Why were they not aware that something left their life? And they did not know. They were sleeping, spiritually sleeping. The Bible says, Jesus said, while men slept, the enemy came in and saw tears among their wheat. They were not aware. They didn't even know. Ah, when did I lose this thing? I don't even know. This virtue that I used to have. I used to have a gift. I don't even know. I used to dream and have a lot of prophetic revelation. But now I just sleep and snore. And I don't even remember any dream. Nothing, not a single dot. You know, this prophecy gift, it has stopped. When did it leave? I don't even know what happened. That will not be our portion in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Just like I said of Samson, he lost his strength. He lost his power. He lost his ability as a deliverer of God's people. He lost his place. He lost his position. But we thank God that his hair grew back. Just like he was told of the sons of the prophet, the axe head fell. The axe head fell, hallelujah, and went into the river. But thank God the axe head was recovered. Your axe head will be recovered. Your hair will grow back. There shall be restoration of everything you have lost. Tonight God told me, he said, I'm going to restore my people. I'm going to restore their strength in the name of Jesus, hallelujah. God does not want our spirit man to be weak. Some of us have lost the confidence. We've lost boldness. We've lost courage. You know, the things that we used to do, we've lost it because the enemy used some people to constantly dampen our enthusiasm. Some of us, we have been, people have spoken into our lives, and what they have said to us has caused us to feel we are nothing, we are in nonentity, we feel so timid, we feel so weak, we can't even talk, but that is going to stop tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. God is going to restore your strength. Hallelujah. We need this strength because we are in this season now. We said before that at the end of this COVID-19, God is preparing a church that will be stronger and better than the way we went in, because there is work to be done. And this is the season of preparation for us. He wants us to be strengthened, build up in the spirit. Start building yourself up. Start meditating on the word of God. Start chewing the word of God. Hallelujah. He wants us to be strong. We need the strength of God to forcefully advance the kingdom, forcefully advance, to defend the territories God has given to us, to confront the enemy and overcome the enemy overcomer. You will take back what the devil has stolen from you in the name of Jesus. Oh, Vashakara Baba. We need the strength of God to overcome temptations, temptations that the enemy throws our way. We need to be able to stand in the times of trials and testing and not to be blown about with every wind of doctrine. God will help us in the name of Jesus. God is going to restore our strength. He will restore your courage. He will restore your boldness. He will restore your fire. He will restore your power and your prayer life in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I want you to take the word of God seriously this time. Amen. I won't be able to read all the scriptures. We need to go into the word to strengthen ourselves. You know, the Bible tells us that in 1 John chapter 2, verse 14, that the young men, they were strong because the word of God abided in them. Abided in them. Let the word of God take root on the inside of you. Secondly, you need to be a prayerholic. Prayerholic. Pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. Hallelujah. God will release a fresh grace of prayer upon your life so that you can be a prayer warrior in the name of Jesus Christ. You know, Paul prayed for the Ephesian church, and he said to them, you know, he said in prayer to God that he's praying that God will grant them according to the riches of his glory. That's Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14 to 19. You can read it later. According to his riches of glory, to be strengthened with might through his spirit in the inner man. We need to be strengthened with might. We are in dangerous times. We are in the evil days. We are in perilous times. We need to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man. Hallelujah. I will teach on that another time. And we need to be able to exercise our faith. Finally, I'm going to just read Isaiah 52 and we're going to pray. Isaiah 52 verse 1. Isaiah 52 verse 1. Isaiah 52 verse 1, you might want to open it up. It says, awake, awake, put on your strength, O Zion. Put on your beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city. For the uncircumcised and the unclean shall no longer come to you. I decree that over your life tonight in the name of Jesus. He says, wake up, O Zion, O Ephraim, O bride of Christ, O church of Jesus, wake up from your slumber. Wake up from your apathy. Wake up from your spiritual sleep. Arise in might. He said, put on your strength. He says here, your strength. It means there is a strength that is ours. There is power that is ours. There are virtues that is ours that people can identify us with. The psalmist said in Psalm 74, he says, we do not see our signs. Neither do we know, have any prophet that knows how long. There is a sign that accompanies believers. It must begin to show again that, yes, this person is a believer. I can see the sign in their life. Hallelujah. Put on your strength, O Zion, and put on your beautiful garment. You have dropped it on the floor. Pick it up. Stand in your place. Take your position as a child of the King of Glory, as an ambassador for Jesus on the earth. Don't let the devil intimidate you. Don't let the devil harass you. God wants you to rise up to the place where you are harassing the devil. You are running him out of town in the name of Jesus because you have the capacity of God on the inside of you. Yeah, the enemy throws you sickness. You are saying in the name of Jesus, my body is the temple of the living God. The Holy Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives inside of me. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. That is our strength. Put it on. Hallelujah. Don't let the devil cheat you. Don't let him defraud you. Silence his voice by the power and the authority that God has given unto you. Praise the Lord. I want us to pray. Let's begin to pray for ourselves. Mashakatabaya. Marekodobo. I'm going to lead us into four prayer points quickly. The first prayer point is that, Lord, anything that has been taken out of my life without my knowledge, maybe I have lost something. I didn't even know when he left me. Ah, God, let there be restoration of my spiritual sight, my hearing, God, my prayer life, my passion for the word. Where did it go? Ah, Father, melekoto bayagadagada. Mareka sunda, morekule beshian toba gadeya, robo kala gada gada. Father, I pray, anything that has been taken out of my life without my knowledge, Lord, restore. Father, restore. Come on, pray for yourself. Mareko tobo shabala bababa, restore me. Rakodobo shekelebo, anything, oh God, that has left my life, oh God, without my knowledge, Father, any virtue, any glory, any gifting, any unction, any anointing, ozigabaya, moroko tobo shekelebo shekete, let it be restored. Let it be restored in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Let everybody say amen. The second thing is, you're going to pray. Holy Spirit, wake me up out of every spiritual slumber, any dullness, any coma, anything that make me not know when things leave my life. Wake me up. Wake me up. Spirit of God, let's cry out to God now. Marekolobosha. Maratobo ya gegege. Liporuante ni masoba ya gada. Mobrete boloboje gede bozi garaboze gede boze. Oh Lord, wake me up. Holy Ghost, wake me up out of every spiritual slumber, out of dullness, out of every spiritual coma. In the name of Jesus. Marekoboshaba. Makuriaba dede. Mabroko setene boshta. Makota in. Fills me with strength, marker with vigor, with spiritual vitality. Oh, bada baba baba baba. Neka, fortify me with strength and power. Lego robo shabara baba. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Thirdly, we're going to pray. Lord, restore my strength. Restore my power. Restore my lost virtues. In the name of Jesus, strengthen me by your spirit in the inner man. I don't want to be weak. In Jesus' name, let's begin to pray. Maragedegelebo sokorababa. Mareko shekelebo. Maroko posubrandegelebo. Marako posotobosha. Makoria konobo zekele. Korebekelebo zubregedebe. Oriako toboshe. Origaba lebo sokorababa. Oh God, strengthen me by your spirit in the inner man. I don't want to be a prey for the enemy. Oh, an easy prey or easy target. Oh Jesus. Morika labo zekerebo sheketebo yada. Moreketelebo. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Finally, we're going to pray. Just as Paul prayed for the Ephesian church. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17 and 18. That the eyes of my spirit will be enlightened, that I may know, hallelujah, all the things that are mine in Christ Jesus. That I may know my position. I may know my power. I may understand and have revelation. I need light. Lord, flood the eyes of my spirit with light, with revelation, so that I know who I am in Christ and operate on that capacity, on that level. In the name of Jesus, lift up your voice and pray. Regodobo shabaya, makotobo yegedebo rigadabole, mabrakotobo lobosha, makaboria gedelebosta. In the name of Jesus, oriakaboloboshe. Lord, grant me the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of revelation. Flood the eyes of my spirit with light, with revelation, with understanding of divine truth. Oh God, that all the promises of God that are in Christ cause me to have a deep understanding, a deep revelation, so I may know who I am and operate in that way, operate in that capacity, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Hallelujah. Can we give God praise? Let's begin to adore the Lord. Let's thank him for tonight. Let's thank him for the word of God that has come to us. Let's thank him for the prayers that we have prayed. Hallelujah. Father, we worship you. Father, we exalt you. Father, we adore you. We give you praise. I just feel that even as we're praying, as the message was coming, that the Spirit of God was doing something in the hearts of some people, in the lives of some people. You are shedding away old garments. You are shedding away the things of the past, and you are putting on the new, even in this time. Koriabaleke sentere bobo. Marakoko poshaya. Helika sontere baba. Marakoko poshaya da baba. Thank you, Lord. Masoriabasha. In Jesus' mighty name. Oh, thank you, Lord. We are going to be taking our communion now. Even though we are not together, but like I said earlier, distance is not a barrier. If you have all your communion elements with you there, hallelujah. We want you to, you know, bring it out now. Your bread, your wine. If you don't have any wine, please, you can use juice, you know, Ribena, and you can use water if you don't have any. We are going to just stand in faith and believe. You know, even though this is a communion that we are taking, we must do it in faith. Jesus commanded us that we should take this as often as we do this in remembrance of him. We are remembering his sacrifice. We are remembering his love for us. We are remembering his blood that was shed for us. We are remembering every finished work of Christ that is ours. We are remembering tonight. And we know there is power in the blood of Jesus. There is power in that blood, because the life of the flesh is in the blood. And Jesus has given his life through his blood. And with that blood, he has purchased our redemption. Hey, Kalebo Sotoya. And it is a speaking blood. Amen. It is a blood, Hebrews chapter 12, that is speaking better things than the blood of Abel. It's a speaking blood. And it's speaking over our lives. It's speaking forgiveness and mercy. It's speaking, hallelujah, Koreba, victory, victory, victory over our lives in Jesus' name. Please, let's take our elements in our hands. We're going to take it in our hands, and then we are going to pray. I want you to release your faith. If there's any sickness in your body, any oppression, any affliction of the devil, anything that the enemy has done, harassment and torment, whatever it is that is doing in your life, because it's illegal, you're a child of God. So we are going to come against it. We are going to confront it headlong. We are going to contend with it. And we are going to contend for your healing tonight in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. So release your faith. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the precious body of Jesus that was broken, battered, and bruised for our healing. I thank you for the blood of Jesus that was shed for our redemption, for our atonement. I thank you, Father, because there's power in that blood. And as we're going to begin to take these elements together, I begin to release now the life of God and the power of God to flow, oh God, through the screen to everyone who is partaking of this communion. Every sickness, I command your power to be broken. I rebuke any kind of ailment, any affliction, every oppression, every nightmares of the devil, every night activity around you, every satanic injection that was injected into you in the sleep. In Jesus' name, I cancel it. I say it's purged out. Right now, I come against every sickness, coronavirus. I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Loose your hold. I come against every arthritis. I come against high blood pressure, high blood sugar, in the name of Jesus. I come against every stomach condition. We command every power of infirmity to be broken tonight in Jesus' name. We release life into your body. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Let's take the bread. Let's break the body and take it together in the name of Jesus. And let's take the blood of Jesus together. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise ye the Lord. Thank you. Let's begin to thank the Lord for that precious, precious blood of Jesus. Lord, we are grateful. We thank you so much for what you are doing in our bodies right now. You're flushing out things from people's system. You're flushing out every satanic deposit, every demonic poison, sickness, afflictions. Be purged out. Thank you, Father. We are grateful, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. We give you glory, Lord. We give you praises. Hallelujah. The blood of Jesus, oh, makes us whole, makes us whole.
Curia de Bosso Toya Nedededen. Curia la Boschen. There is power mighty in the blood. There is power mighty in the blood. There is power mighty in the blood of Jesus Christ. There is power mighty in the blood. One more time. There is power mighty in the blood. Oh, in the blood. There is power mighty in the blood. In the blood. There is power mighty in the blood of Jesus Christ. There is power mighty in the blood. Hallelujah. I just sense as we're praying, there's a man and a woman standing in their living room, even right now, and the husband is laying hands on the wife, and the husband is agreeing, is, you know, connecting to the prayer and agreeing and praying for his wife. And I want to say to you that even that woman, the Lord is healing you. The Lord is healing you. That which you are standing in faith for, God has heard your prayer and you are healed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's bless the name of the Lord. Let's bless the name of the Lord. I sense that somebody, it's as if your nose is blocked. Your nose is the upper part of your nose, like sinuses. The Spirit of God is touching you and opening up your nose, and you are being healed. You are being healed in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Come on, begin to bless the Lord. We worship you, adore you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. I'm seeing a pregnant woman. You are concerned and worried about the pregnancy you are carrying, but the Lord said he will see you through. He will be with you. You will deliver that baby safe without any complications. Thank you, Father. We bless your name. We give you glory, Lord. Healing to your hand. Healing to your hand. I'm seeing somebody with a POP on their hand. The Lord is bringing healing to that hand. Is healing your hand. The pain disappears in the name of Jesus. We worship you, Lord. We glorify your name. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you have any praise report, you have any feedback, please send it to us by text. We'd love to hear it. I remember last week that I was talking about somebody. I saw a shofar, you know, on somebody's mouth being blown. One of the ladies sent me a message saying immediately I said that she just started blowing and screaming, you know, like a shofar. So we could see that it was her that the Lord was speaking about. We give God all the praise. So if you have any testimony, any praise report, feedbacks, please send us a message. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We want to thank God. We've come to the end of our broadcast. We want to also announce that we have a 12 midnight prayer meeting on the phone and 5 a.m. And God is raising an army, a strong army. Hallelujah. A strong recovery army. So we want you to join us. Every day we are on the prayer line, praying, hallelujah, for nations and for the church and for individuals. God bless you. Thank you for watching. Every one of you that has joined, hallelujah. Praise reports. Yeah, that is the number on the screen. If you have a praise report, send it to that phone number. If you can put it back on the screen so that people can see the number and copy it and send the praise report to us. Amen. I want to thank everyone that joined. I want to thank all those who led prayers, all our leaders, Pastor Nii, Pastor Sheyi, Minister Timmy, and my darling husband, Pastor Nii John.
Thank you all for the time of prayer. I pray that everything you have received tonight, you will never lose it in the name of Jesus. It shall be permanent in your life in Jesus' mighty name. Same time next week, join us for our prophetic prayer meeting. God bless you and God keep you, and God cause his face to shine upon you and give you peace. Good night, everybody. God bless. Bye. Oh, yes. Bye. Sorry, we have not taken the offering. Yes, don't go. Yes, we are supposed to take offering. Thank you for sending me a text. Thank you for those who are sending me all these texts. They've left. Please, those of you who know the account number, please just give your offering. You know, you can see that, God help us. Give your offering. You already know the number if it's not displayed. Some people are still online, so can you please display the account details? Some people want to give. Is it being displayed now? Okay, it's being displayed. Thank you. God bless you. God bless you. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. God bless you. Goodbye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.